Wow. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming. My name is Micah White. I want to thank Peter and Kaylin and Melissa for helping to organize, and for you all for coming to hear about my book at this very important time in human history. I'm grateful to be here. This is, I think, as we all kind of know, the most important time in human history, where we face a series of global challenges. And one of the ways, the only way, I think, that we're going to be able to solve those global challenges is through the creation of global social movements that allow us to suddenly de-pattern ourselves and motivate and mobilize people on a large global scale. So then the challenge, of course, becomes, well, how do you create these global social movements? How do you create these powerful manifestations that are actually going to create the kind of change that we want? So that's what my book is about. You all have a copy, so I don't want to just like read from it. Instead, I want to kind of talk about the book, talk about the core ideas of the book, and then take your questions, and we can open up into a discussion and make it kind of more interesting, okay? So, but there's, what I want to do is I want to kind of like give you an overview in three main areas, three main points. The first is kind of a history, the second is a little bit of a theory, and then the third is kind of like a practical analysis of like, well, what can we learn from this, okay? So, first off, the end of protest doesn't mean the absence of protest. I think this is very important for people to understand. The end of protest doesn't mean the absence of protest. It instead means the proliferation of ineffective protest. We actually live in a time of growing and increasing protest, in both in the frequency and the size of the protest. Right now, just yesterday, there was a protest of 1 million people in Brazil. And so we're living through a time when the size of protests keeps increasing, and so does the frequency. So the end of protests, but these protests seem to be ineffective. They're no longer achieving the kind of social change that the participants within the movements are dreaming of. So that's what the end of protest means. And I first want to kind of give you a historical overview. I know we're in New York City, so I'm sure a lot of you guys went down to Occupy Wall Street and Zuccotti and like experienced the movement. But I want to give you the kind of a historical overview from my perspective. I was living in Berkeley, California, the editor at Adbusters, and how we kind of created the movement. So if you go back to that time in 2011, there was this amazing, magical moment. It started in Tunisia when a fruit seller set himself on fire. And it suddenly unleashed the pent-up rage of a generation. And it spread to Egypt, where more people started to set themselves on fire. And they started to do the Tahrir Square uprising. People started to camp in this square. And then in February, Hosni Mubarak stepped down, and the whole kind of like global people's movement had like a victory. It felt like at that time, a tremendous victory. And then the movement grew and it spread to Spain, where the people of Spain, if you remember, started to occupy their squares, and they started to hold these general consensus-based assemblies. So at the time, I was an editor at Adbusters magazine, which is an anti-consumerism magazine based out of Vancouver. And in a conversation, a brainstorm with the founder, we kind of came up with this idea that we should basically combine the model of the Tahrir uprising, which is to go to a place of symbolic importance, with the model of Spain, which is to hold these consensus-based assemblies, and we should do it on Wall Street. So we wrote a tactical briefing, that's what we called it, where we explained the strategic significance of linking these two tactics together, and we created a poster, and we released it onto the internet, and within 24 hours, people started taking it up. People in New York City started taking it up. And we very quickly lost like control of the movement. We didn't try to keep control of the movement, but it was very important that it immediately basically transferred to the local participants. And we kind of, that's what we welcomed. That was part of the model that we were trying to do. And it was amazing success. I'm sure everyone kind of remembers the things that happened, and there was parts of it that were really beautiful. But of course, within 2 months, it was crushed. They evicted Zuccotti, they infiltrated the movement, they arrested, you know, people, and 7,000 people were arrested in the movement. People died in Occupy Wall Street, which I think is something that people don't really think about, is that that some people actually died. In Vancouver, someone died. In Oakland, someone died. People died elsewhere, too. Okay, so basically the key idea here is that a social movement is created from the combination of a contagious mood and a new tactic. At the time of the Arab Spring and Occupy Wall Street, the contagious mood was one of fearlessness. People suddenly losing their fear and rushing into the streets, doing these abnormal behaviors. And the new tactic was the combination of what was going on in Egypt with Spain and giving it kind of an American spin. So that was the kind of historical overview. Now let's talk about the kind of theory. What does this mean for like social movements and social movement creation? I call Occupy Wall Street a constructive failure, which means that it was not a total failure, but it was a failure that revealed the limitations of contemporary protest. And there's a kind of narrative within activism that I think is really important to resist, and that narrative is that there is no such thing as failure, there is no such thing as defeat, we've always been succeeding, and Occupy didn't die, it just like splintered into 1,000 shards of light, and like it was actually amazing and we actually won. Okay, that is really uplifting and positive storyline that I think gets a lot more maybe like tweets and retweets, but it's not a storyline that actually allows us to understand what happened. Why did the movement not achieve its goal? If you go back to read the original tactical briefing, you'll see very clearly that the Occupy Wall Street movement was created to get money out of politics. That was the goal. The goal was to overturn Citizens United, the court decision that allows unions and corporations to give unlimited money to candidates. That was the literal goal. And that would have been revolutionary. I talk about my book, The Definition of Revolution, but that would have been revolutionary precisely because it's the overturning of a law of the highest court. It would be a switch in legal regime. So we didn't achieve that. In fact, now, even with Bernie Sanders, we see that he has to fight at the level of, well, I raised this much money. Look how great I'm doing. So Occupy was a constructive failure that showed the limitations of contemporary protests. The core idea of contemporary protest up until now has been that if you can get millions of people into the streets doing synchronized behaviors, mostly nonviolently, around a unified message, then social change will happen. I talk about in my book more about why I think this is not true, so you guys can kind of read that. But that said, I want to lay out, well, what is a alternative in a theory of social change then, okay? And in my book, I develop a way of thinking about it I think you guys will find very useful and important and helpful. I call it kind of like a unified theory. I think it's on page 71. So there's a grid, and basically, I'll break it down though, is that revolution is the interaction between humans and natural or forces outside of humanity. So one option, there's four basic options. On the left hand, if you imagine a grid, it's on page 71, but if you imagine a grid, on the left side is the idea that revolution is something that involves humans. And on the right side would be some revolutions are things that don't involve humans. On the bottom part of the grid would be the idea that revolutions involve natural forces, material forces. And on the top part of the grid is the idea that no, revolutions involve immaterial, supernatural, spiritual forces. Okay? So in the bottom left-hand part of the grid is the idea of called voluntarism. And this is the core concept of contemporary activism. This is the concept that dictates all of contemporary activism. And that's the idea that revolution and social change is the result of humans doing behaviors, certain behaviors. Those behaviors, we know what they are. They are marching, but they involve physical action, like direct action. The idea of direct action is voluntarist, okay? And it means that if you want to change the world, then it's simply a matter of convincing as many people as possible to do these direct actions. That's one theory, the dominant theory. But there's another option. It's on the right-hand side. It's this idea that actually revolution is a process that does not involve humans, but is material. This is called structuralism. It's the idea that revolutions are the result of structural economic factors outside of the control of human agency. For example, there has been a compelling study that says that revolutions are caused by food price increases. And that you can actually, like if you look at the Arab Spring and Occupy, they coincided with record high food prices. And if you look at the decline of Occupy Wall Street, it actually coincides with the decline of food prices. So they would say, there's no point in trying to mobilize people to go into the streets, just monitor the food price index. And when it reaches a certain threshold, these scientists have even defined what they think that threshold is. When it reaches that threshold, well, then it's a revolutionary moment. And social change is gonna happen. So that's one option. The third option is this idea that revolution is a human process that doesn't involve the natural world at all. It's called subjectivism. It's the idea that revolution is a change in mind. And if you want to have social change, then all you have to do is change how you see the world. If you want to change the world, change how you see the world. I think we're like becoming more familiar with this idea, right? So meditation would be the highest form of activism. The best form of direct action would be to meditate and change how you see the world. But then there's a fourth option, and this is that revolution is a process that doesn't involve humans, but also is supernatural. And this is the idea that revolution is the product of divine intervention, and that revolution is something that can only be brought about through prayer and stuff like that. And I know that this is where secular Western activists start to get uncomfortable. How dare we buck the trend of Marxist historical materialism? All revolutions must purely be a kind of like natural process. But in my book, I kind of go into and I provide some examples of theurgistic, theurgistic social movements. You know, I think the best example being Constantine's victory that ushered in Christianity. Constantine saw a cross in the sky and had a vision of Jesus at night, and that's why Christianity conquered the world. So I go into some more details in there. So the core idea, though, that I want to get across to you is not to just pick one of these four theories of activism, but instead to allow yourself to travel throughout all four of them and occupy all four perspectives, because revolution is a combination of the four. That's the key thing, is that Occupy Wall Street combined all four elements. It was voluntarist in the sense that we got people to do new kinds of social behaviors like consensus-based assemblies and twinkle fingers. It was structuralist because at that time the food prices were out of control, okay? It was also subjectivist because it did have this element of like suddenly seeing the world differently. And if you go back at that time, you'll see people meditating in the squares. But it was also theurgistic and involved divine elements. And if you look back at the weird circumstances around the eruption of the movement, for example, the hurricane that hit right before it came out, and there was even a mini stock market crash like the week before Occupy. So there was strange stuff in the air. Okay, one way of thinking about this is like, you know, in insurance policies they talk about like acts of God. Okay, it's like that kind of like freak weather stuff, you know. So that's the theory. Now I want to just, you know, say a couple more things, and then I think it's just important to like get an opportunity to answer your questions. I live in rural Oregon, so where I live there's 280 people. And so it's a really different environment. And when I come to like the cities, it always just like there's more people on the street in one block than live in my entire community. So that means there's not much opportunity to speak to me about these things. So it's great to be here, and you guys can ask me anything you want, and we'll open it up. But the last thing I want to do, and I want to draw attention to in my book, because I think that a lot of the reviews that have come out so far and people talking about it, they're keying very strongly in on the spiritual element. And so that's cool, but there's other parts of my book that I really want to highlight for people and bring forward. The thing I want to talk about now is the practical advice and what I call the three revolutionary scenarios for the future, and what I kind of see as potential places where we could see a revolutionary social movement arise, okay? The first one, as I just mentioned, is I live in rural Oregon. I think rural communities in this country are really ripe for a surprising and amazing social movement that is able to concretely gain power in these places. Where I live, there's 280 people. There's no police. They have to borrow the police from the nearby town. The city council is like basically, I mean, there's 280 people. You only need to get like 50 votes to get onto city council, you know. And so it would be very easy. And I kind of talk about this in my book. It would be very easy to win actual sovereignty. I think the fundamental problem with Occupy Wall Street is that we thought that just by holding these general assemblies, that somehow magically we would get sovereignty, and that the police wouldn't be able to break up the assembly because somehow we were like this perfect form of democracy. It's like this magical thinking, this magical narrative that we kind of went through. But in actual reality, like, there's rural communities where the population is graying out to such a degree that it is quite simple to, I think, gain power. And once you do, I kind of talk about a strategy of linking them together in a kind of mundialization. So the first idea is this idea of rural revolt. I think we should, and I don't know if you guys have been tuned into the Oregon occupation that just happened like last month, and they killed. This is fascinating that no one knows about it. You gotta check this out. In rural Oregon, in eastern Oregon, these militia people occupied a wildlife refuge in order to and they were gonna stay until their demand was met. It was very Occupy Wall Street, but they had guns and they're the right wing and we don't like them, fine, so we like ignore them. But not looking at their politics, which I disagree with, obviously, but looking instead at the newness of their behavior and what it indicates, though, for the ripeness of a rural revolt. And you know what the federal government did is they killed the spokesperson. They shot him dead. So obviously they're taking it seriously. They shot him dead, then they arrested all the people, they arrested the father of the main organizers and his sons. So the entire family has been put in federal prison. Anyways, just to like get a sense, wow, this is some serious stuff happening in rural areas. The second core idea, second revolutionary scenario I think people should pay attention to, I talk about in my book, is the idea of a world party led by women that can win elections in multiple countries in order to carry out a unified political agenda. I think that, as I said earlier, we face these, all of the challenges that we face right now are global challenges that can only be solved by a global social movement. And just talking realistically and strategically, the only way to actually achieve, I think, the goals that we want is to gain sovereignty. And so I imagine in the book a global social movement that can win elections in multiple countries in order to carry out a unified political agenda. And like, so how would that work? One of the things I mentioned in the book is the idea that right now we're very good at creating synchronized global events, right? We can get like millions of people to march on the same day all over the world. But instead, if we put all of the world's elections in chronological order, for example, the America's election is in November, but then in December there might be an election in Nigeria, then July there's, so you put them in chronological order and then imagine a movement that was able to kind of swing the election in each place from country to country. This is kind of the core idea I'm talking about. Okay, so world revolt, women-led world party, and the third one is this idea of autonomous kind of protest bots that are used to distribute social movements on the internet. And actually it sounds kind of far-fetched, but I just read an article recently that ISIS is actually doing this. They're using like Twitter bots that, spew memes and stuff like that. So the third revolutionary scenario is imagining like, imagine you go onto Twitter and there's like a bot basically that starts talking to you and is like, oh, did you hear about this movement? Like, let me show you some memes. And like, it starts recruiting people and it's not run by any human, it's just autonomously out there. So those are the three revolutionary scenarios and an overview of kind of the theory that of social change. And then the last thing I want to say before I kind of take your questions is that, I was doing an interview today and the interviewer asked me this good question and I want to reply to it publicly. She said, well, what do you say to someone like me who is maybe more timid and not necessarily interested in like going to like large-scale protest events, maybe I'm a little bit more introverted, like what should I do, okay? So I think that the core thing to understand is that the activist culture has been overly limited by its conception of protests. We only think of protests within a very narrow bound, but if we liberate ourselves using the unified theory that I talked about, then we realize that protest is just a behavior that you believe creates social change. That's all it is. And so that behavior can actually be a wide range of things. And so at its fundamental level, I think that it's about being an activist is about living the life you imagined and losing your fear and living courageously, because that's what inspires other people to also live courageously. Social movements are created when people see others letting go and just like doing the actions they dream. So I think that my advice to someone who says, well, I don't know if I should go protest, then it's not about protesting in old ways, it's about innovating new ways, and above all, it's about living an authentic life, living the life you've truly imagined. Okay, and with that, I want to take your questions and we can kind of open it up.
Yeah, if you want to raise your hand, I'll bring you the mic. We can kind of get a discussion going. I know it's a big step to take the first chunk.
Why rural Oregon? why was that the place I ended up?
Yeah.
Well, I think I'm sure there's people in this room that were participating in Occupy and experienced Occupy, and I think that there was that brief moment when we actually thought like we were gonna win. I mean, if anyone was there, I think we all experienced that. And then to have it collapse was, I think, for a lot of people, myself included, extremely traumatic. And I think that we all dealt with it in different ways, but the way I dealt with it is my wife and I moved to rural Oregon, where we live on the Oregon coast. It's beautiful. It's the most beautiful place we'd ever been. That's why we picked it. It's forests. Although now that I'm there, I'm learning more about the clear cutting and the forest industry and how the forests are actually these tree farms owned by Wall Street, which is fascinating. But now that I'm there, and the best part about living in a rural area is it forces you to become more sophisticated in your thinking about activism, because urban activist tactics do not translate to a town of 280 people. You cannot do Black Lives Matter, I'm gonna block the street, when there are no big businesses and everyone there knows you and where you live, and you actually don't want to alienate your neighbors because they're like fine people. So I think in the urban areas, it's easy to kind of like blindly dislike a nameless and amorphous existence that you see like riding taxis and limos and stuff. But in a rural area where everyone's struggling and poor, I mean, everyone's not kind of on the same side. And so that forces you immediately, well, how would you protest in this place? And then you start to come up with like, oh, well, you would try to gain sovereignty, obviously. You would try to own this city politically so you could carry out. I mean, you could do anything. Once you own city council in these small, federally recognized cities, you could do, you know, you could have anything. Imagination. I'm not going to say what I think about that, but I think you could do pretty much anything. Yeah. Who's next? Jerry, you want to ask a question? Am I on the city council? No, but we have an election coming up in November, obviously. And so I think that for me personally, you know, in my book, I talk about the these people's parties. And for me, so if you look at, there's a couple developing in Europe and each one's using a different model. And so there's the five-star movement in Italy, which, you know, I think their model, and there's Podemos in Spain, which is like a social movement, only took like 2 years, and now they're like a huge party. And there's a five-star movement in Italy, which has been around 5 or 6 years. And the difference between the five-star movement in Italy and Podemos in Spain, one of the differences is that the leader of the five-star movement doesn't run for office, whereas the leader of Podemos does. And I kind of tend towards the other of not running option. I think that it's more important to, I mean, there's people in my town who have lived there like 30 years. I think it's more and have never tried to run for office. I'm more interested in kind of mobilizing those people. So that's kind of what we're doing, is that trying to get them to realize that they can take control of their own community versus like the, you know, opposite, which would be like, I'm going to somehow like be telling you guys what to do, which isn't. Well, I think that the challenge, you know, this whole question of leaderlessness, the challenge is the deeper challenge than cultivating charismatic single individuals, which is what we are good at doing now. I still think that the deeper challenge is how to cultivate social movements that can make complex decisions that are traditionally associated only with having leaders. So I think that I think there's limitations to leaderlessness, et cetera, but I think that actually for the long term and from a strategic perspective, in the long term, we must solve the challenge of how do you create a social movement that can make complex decisions versus we need to keep cultivating leadership style, Bernie Sanders style, you know, DeRay or whatever these like, because it's just, I mean, obviously each one just becomes, it's so easy to become corrupted. You know, that's just the reality of the situation. Gentleman with the hat, yes. Yes. Wow.
And you're very impressive. I think the fact you have to explore the new life. This has to be done by people in the community.
Mm-hmm.
I've been doing this for 10 years. I've been traveling 5 times during the United States, in Europe, I've been out in Europe. And we're all familiar with all the problems.
Yeah.
I was spent weeks in Washington. I talked to our electors, everything. You listen to the media, all of the media, bad news. We have to actually educate ourselves and learn how to talk positive.
Totally. I think.
Where do you start? You gotta start it.
Yes. Thank you.
So what is our problem? Our problem is we
Thank you.
No organization, people, if they gather, so I started a program with 10 people. You always invite them here. You have commanders, organizations, local organizations, invite those 1, 2, 3. Then you start.
Wait, hold on. Is it okay if, it sounds like you gave us a really good teaser, and now people can like find you and talk to you about this, and you, I'm sure you have a website, so you can like, people can kind of take this up, because I don't want to slow things down, and we'll take a few more questions, and people will find you, and thank you. Ah, I am key. But this is the thing, you know, I'm going to be honest with you about that, what you just said. I think actually that I am not the key, okay? Because people put their hopes on others when they should put them on themselves. And the thing that we did with Occupy Wall Street is that we actually inspired other people to do the actions themselves. And very, very few people even knew about who we were. In fact, the like best article about Occupy Wall Street wasn't even published until after the Zuccotti occupation was over. To the point, so I think that's crucial. And I think that that people email me all the time with their ideas and they say like, well, if only you would like kind of like promote this idea, then we would finally succeed. And instead, I mean, I just don't think that's the truth. So, but I think that you're already doing your vision.
Yeah.
Sounds awesome. Okay.
Because you want to be affiliated, you don't have to get organized. People got to organize themselves, but have the opportunity to share their information, their wisdom with the rest of the world.
Wow.
When we do this, let it grow. We have no expectation. Because, hey, for 2,000 years, each other, okay?
No. We're going to go to another question, but thank you. I really appreciate that you came this far, and I think other people are going to seek you out, and we'll talk about it. And I have your email, so we can keep communicating. So thank you so much. Okay, is there another question that we want to kind of go? Yeah, go ahead.
Hi, I'm from India.
Right, yeah. Right.
And it's okay when you're occupied by a dictatorship.
Right.
And when you're in a country like India or in the US, where there's democracy in place.
Right.
Yeah,
totally. And I think that there's interesting arguments that say that there's never been a revolution in a democratic country because there's something about these democratic countries. Never been a revolution in the sense of like a Russian revolution, like an armed insurrectionary overthrow of a democratic government. So that there's something about the structure of democratic governments that is immune to revolution. So I think that, I personally think that's not true. I think that instead, there's been this a very insidious and effective job done to promulgate ineffective protest strategies within democratic countries. I think that instead protest has become part of the political spectacle, and it's become part of the political spectacle to the degree that participants themselves use words like revolution with a complete detachment from what a revolution would actually look like. I think with Occupy Wall Street, we actually were using revolution in a literal sense, and we believed it so briefly before we were smashed. And I think that that's one of the reasons why we were smashed, one of the reasons why Obama didn't use the name of our movement until he had evicted us and all this kind of stuff. But I think that the deep answer to your question, I think, is the idea that is the realization that protest and revolution are forms of warfare. They are forms of warfare because they are politics by other means. And they are forms of warfare designed to change the legal regime of a government. So if you start to see that protest is a form of war, that we're actually at war with our government, and we're trying to overthrow or at least change the legal regime in which we live, then you start to like understand, well, that's why I can't repeat tactics. You know, if someone came to you and said, I'm going to fight the next war like they did in the 19th century, then you would laugh at them. Because in the domain of war, we understand you have to constantly innovate and this kind of stuff. But war doesn't mean it has to be violent. That's the key thing. And I think that's kind of like the direction of my thinking now is, I think in fact that even more so, it seems that nonviolent social movements are the most effective kind of war. like even more so, it seems that governments are increasingly going towards the direction of exporting social movements abroad in order to topple governments and regimes, and that this is done most effectively when they are nonviolent. So I agree with you absolutely, and I talk about this in my book, that there's a paradox, which is that Western governments celebrate protests abroad and use them as a justification for regime change at the same time as they smash them domestically and refuse to tolerate them. And I think that the onus is on activists to up our game. That's the end of the story. You know, I think that as activists, we're complicit because we have allowed. Let's put it this way. There's a reason why Occupy Wall Street had to have been created by a Canadian magazine. And why didn't any American activist organization call, even though we all knew we needed something in America, why did none of them call for something effective that created something like Occupy? Because American activism is risk averse. American activism has been co-opted by the very forces that we pretend that we're against. This is the literal truth. And that they have co-opted at the highest levels, and it's, you know, so that's just the reality. So I think that as activists, you just kind of acknowledge the reality, and you stop fetishizing the past. I think part of the problem also is a fetishization of, like, as if we're going to have an armed insurrection in America. I'm sorry, it's not going to happen. But a nonviolent social movement that topples the American government and institutes some sort of, like, collaborative decision-making process that's as yet unimagined, that I think is possible, you know? So that's kind of, and I think India is a really good example, because India has had the largest protests in human history. I mean, like, they've had like 100 million people or something, like absurd numbers of people, right, in the streets, and with the general strike that happened. And like, so it's like, so India is I think a perfect test case for how governments can ride out even protest sizes that we in America have never experienced before. Like, they would just, and we'll see what happens in Brazil now with the 1 million people. And but before we get to Jerry, is there another question, and then we'll come back to, what about on this side of the room? There's a lot of attentive people over here. Go ahead. Yeah. Right. 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 So, yeah. Well, I think that most of us are asleep, and yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I want to, totally. Yeah, I want to reply to that first thing you said, though. I think it's really important, which is that why was it that Occupy rejected political involvement in the establishment, okay? This is like really important to understand about the nature of protests, is that I think each protest and each social movement is basically an experiment. And with Occupy Wall Street, we were testing a certain hypothesis about how social change happened. And that hypothesis was imported from Spain. In Spain, if you look at their movement, it also took place right before an election. And they also said, you don't represent us, we're not voting. And then what happened? The right wing swept into power. And now they've learned, and now they have Podemos. And now Podemos is sweeping into power. So I think it's beholden on American activists to understand that, yeah, we tested a hypothesis about refusing to be engaged in political process. And instead of retreating back to the old standard model of Bernie Sanders or this like this idea of another progressive leader, what we need to do is again import from Europe their concept, which is correct, which is a social movement that wins power, not an old style party. This is crucial for people to like start to look into what's happening, the Five Star Movement, Podemos, and they've just launched a new one, this Diem, which is a European-wide social movement political party hybrid. And these are the future, you know? So American activism, we in America, quite frankly, are behind. but each social movement, but the point is that each social movement tests a hypothesis, and it's beholden on us to learn from that hypothesis what worked, what didn't, and then evolve our strategy. That's the key. Yeah, of course. The media is. Yeah. 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 Yeah, I mean, to respond to that point, you know, that was, again, the nature of the movement, which was that when we, if you go back and read the original tactical briefing, you know, like, when we put out the call, it was taken up by a certain subset of American New York activists who believed in prefigurative anarchism. And it wasn't up, we didn't pick who would respond to the call. And that's who it was. So that's what happened. And it wasn't like, you know, I had never heard the term prefigurative anarchism. And I would say to them, like, this idea that your guys are gonna somehow like, they would tell me, oh, it's okay, we have so much money that we're gonna buy $40,000 winter tents and we're gonna just spend the entire winter in the park. And I'm like, no, you're not. Not because it's too cold, but because it's too long. You cannot do a social movement indefinitely. That is literally the truth. Eventually they will evict you because they have to. And I talk about in my book about how we should just, it's either 28 days or bust, that's it. Stop, like the Oregon Wildlife Refuge people made the same mistake. They're like, we're gonna stay forever. It's like, no, you're not. Encirclement is the number, military history, there's never been a war won by the encircled side. No one who's been encircled has ever won a war. You know, it's like, boom, fact. Okay, but we have a question. Did you have a question in the back? Yeah. Right. Okay. Okay. Right, right. I understand what you're saying. So I think one of the things that sometimes I'll hear is like, oh, protest is so privileged, like only privileged people could actually protest because like who has the free time and like all this kind of stuff. But I think that actually what that is an underhanded critique of contemporary protests that activists have refused to listen to. I think what they're actually saying is the protest that you're proposing won't solve the problem that I'm facing, which might be true. And if that's true, then why aren't we proposing protests that might actually solve the problems that they're facing? And so there's a, you know, to bring in a horrible a quote from a horrible person. There's a quote by Hitler, though, which I think is extremely insightful about the psychology of mass movements. And he says something like, he says, people don't vote for the strongest horse. They vote for the horse they believe will win. Okay? So right now, we're so fixated on the idea that we need to create the strongest social movement with the most number of people and blah, blah, blah. No, what we need to do is create social movements that people are convinced are going to win. That's when they suddenly join them and side with them. And so I think that it's beholden on us to acknowledge the critique and say, you're right. I need to create a movement that inspires people who see it to believe that if they give up and risk themselves by joining this thing, then it might actually solve the fundamental problems that they face. And I think that Occupy Wall Street did do that. We convinced people for like, you know, at least 60 days that if they risk their lives, risk their jobs, possibly getting arrested, 7,000 people were arrested. That's pretty good evidence that they believed. If they were to join our movement, then we just might solve a fundamental problem in American society and that it would be better for all of us. You know, we convinced people of that. So I think that it's, you know, again, it gets back to this false optimism within activism and the failure to actually listen to critiques that don't come out of an anti-protest. Like, I'm not anti-protest. I love protest. I've been protesting since I'm 17. You can read in my book, like, the only thing I've ever done in my life is activism. So I'm not saying don't protest. I'm saying protest differently, you know? And I think that movements suddenly gain mass membership when the people start to think, oh, yeah, this is it. This is the one I've been waiting for. You know, and it's about creating that magical sense of possibility. So, yeah. Right, but it. Again, I'm gonna push back a little bit against this. So there is another narrative among contemporary activism that is basically, our movements are designed to spread awareness. Our movements are designed to raise awareness around the fact that black people are killed by police, or that Citizens United exists in this country. No, I think that is not true. Movements are not designed to spread awareness. Awareness is a byproduct and a symptom of an effective movement. So I think that, you know, in my book, I get into an example, you know, so the kind of the extension of the argument that you're making is if only there was a movement that had a clear and unified demand, then it would have succeeded. But let's go back 2003 to the global anti-war movement that did have a clear demand all over the world, everyone saying no. If you Google 2003 Iraq anti-war, you will see pictures where everyone in the crowd is using the exact same poster. It just says no, no to the war. And it did not stop the war. So what I'm saying is, like, I'm also skeptical of the narrative that movements need to do raise awareness or have a clear message or these kind of things. No, what movements need to do is convince participants that it's going to result in a regime change, a legal regime change in their government, and that it will be something positive, you know. And then it succeeds. So it's kind of like, yeah, stuff to think about. And there's a lot of stuff in my book about this kind of these questions. I'm gonna go because I haven't heard from you, so. Okay. I think that argument, so starting with the last question first, that argument is something that has, it's like a defeatist position that has permeated the left since like Hitler. The same thing was said by defeated communists in Germany that, well, damn the people for not joining my movement. They'll learn when Hitler comes to power, then suddenly they'll join me. It's the disgruntled behavior of people who haven't been able to create a social movement that resonates with large numbers of people. So I completely reject that idea. You don't, like, in what kind of war do you say, like, well, once the other side wins, then I'll come back and I'm really strong and I'll get them, you know? It's like, no, this is a battle and you never have a second chance. One of the quotes in my book talk about from Napoleon is, you know, once the decisive moment is lost, it never returns. You know, this is something people think.
I mean, the Trump thing, I think, too, is that someone mentioned our level of emerging technology. So many people do see. And that's the behind that is that people could be ripped out of their leather.
Right.
By having such a.
Right. I think that movements are based on contagious like I said, they're based on contagious moods combined with new tactics. And I think that the contagious mood in particular that inspires social movements is a loss of fear, not an increase in fear. So I think that Trump increases fear, and what we need to do is create a movement that makes people lose their fear. But I will reply to the other question about Bernie and Trump, and I'm probably, because you've all like bought my book, you can read about this, but I will tell you the truth, what I believe, which is I live in rural Oregon and I'm completely tuned out of their what's going on with that stuff, and I'm not voting. I think that Americans constantly fall for the same bait and switch, which is, here's your progressive candidate. Oh, sorry, they didn't win the primary. Guess you got to vote for the Democrat over here because we don't want Trump to win or Bush or this guy. And we constantly, whereas what we need to be doing is like just tune into what's going on in Europe and the creation of social movements, literally social movements, just like Occupy, that are winning political parties, winning political elections. You know, like it's happening already. And so I think that Bernie Sanders is the last gasp of that old model, and that I pray that activists are going to learn the lesson that's happening in Europe. I mean, it's hard to believe, but like in Podemos, it took them like 2 or 3 years to become like the third largest political party in their country. That's how quickly the growth can happen now. So. Okay. Here's another thing, another way of thinking about that question. I think it's a really important question. So this is from Trotsky. It's a really interesting thing he says, which he says, don't confuse the tail with the head. This is what we are doing right now. We are confusing the tail, which is Bernie Sanders coming 5 years after Occupy using the same language, with the head, which was Occupy, you know? And so it's another thing that's really important to realize, and this is I think it's really great to study the Russian Revolution because these things come up. Another one that Trotsky kind of observes is that what's revolutionary 1 year might not be revolutionary the next. So it might, when Occupy said get money out of politics, that may have been a revolutionary statement. But when we say get money out of politics in 2016, it might not be a revolutionary statement anymore. And it's very hard for us to understand how does that happen. But I think it has to do with this confusing the tail with the head, the symptom with the cause, you know? So Bernie might be a symptom of Occupy, which was the cause, time to create another cause. and the only way to create the other cause is to do what we don't want to do, which is to imagine how do you create a hybrid political party, social movement that is able to use these new forms of social movement creation that we're developing in order to win elections around the world. And that's the real threat, I think, that they're scared of. Not another Bernie Sanders who's 74 could have a heart attack tomorrow. There's a question in the back, and then we'll bounce back up to Jerry. Has to do to win? I think that what I would do if I were Bernie Sanders is I would do the very thing that he doesn't want to do, which is actually use street protest to get into power, which would be, I think, a revolutionary act. Basically to break the he's still risk averse and not willing to play. He's not actually acting like a revolutionary despite what he's talking about. You know? I think the Russian revolutionaries, the Bolsheviks were terrifying because they were backed by an armed populace of workers and soldiers. And so when they said like, no, now basically we're the new government, there was like this kind of like intense reality to it. So if I were Bernie Sanders, what I would do, I don't think you need guns. Again, I think nonviolent social movement warfare is much more effective. But what I would be doing is I would be working on building the capacity for sudden events near to the election to swing results in unpredictable ways. Imagining like, how Occupy Wall Street suddenly emerged onto the scene, I would do the same thing. I would think about how could I create a social movement eruption around October that would spread across the country and swing the election in an unexpected direction towards me. Because if you had had a presidential election during the height of Occupy Wall Street, Occupy Wall Street started September 17th and we were evicted on November 15th. So if we had had an election 2 weeks before we were evicted, we would have like swept that thing. It would have been insane. At least we would have gotten some serious candidates, some serious votes, right? So the goal is to how do you create a social movement right around the election that completely swings things in an unpredictable way? Of course, that would involve like being a write-in candidate, not trying to win the primaries, doing a different strategy. So that what I'm saying is like he's not acting like he's actually willing to break the system. The Russian Revolution, again, they would talk about smashing the state. You know, like we're going to get in there and we're going to totally break what exists and like put something new in there. I would want to hear more about. that kind of stuff. But you know, it's just, this is just my opinion. I'm much more interested in like this local, this rural areas, and I'm much more interested in the birth of a social movement that wins elections in multiple countries, like I've been saying, which is not my idea, but instead something that's coming out of Europe. So, but we're gonna do Jared. Do you have a question? But does anyone else have a question before we go to people who have already asked a question? Yes, in the back. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, really? You've seen his documentaries? Wow. You should email him and tell him that, because the man is turning 74 March 25th, and I'm sure he would appreciate a little bit of encouragement. I have also seen his documentaries. I was a, how many people know about Adbusters in this room? Okay. Oh, good. See? Okay, I was like a huge Adbusters nerd. I started reading Adbusters when I was like 14 years old, and so working there was my dream job. But I'm not Canadian, so the first time I worked there, I was an intern, and I had to like live illegally in the country as like an immigrant, and it was terrifying. Once I was riding my bike without a helmet, and I got pulled over by this police officer, and I thought for sure I was gonna get like, he was like, where do you live? Like, let me see your, oh, you're American? Like, what are you, and I was just like terrified. So that was my brief experience as a illegal immigrant in a foreign country. But so I had to leave, but I loved Adbusters so much that what I did is I made a job for myself there. In fact, if you love Adbusters, you should get in touch with this guy because he needs people who care. I basically just wrote to him, and what I did is I would say, hey, look at this cool article I found in the library. Like, this would be great for the magazine. And then eventually he was like, okay, I'll start paying you for these. And then eventually I was like, hey, here's an article I wrote. This would be really great. And he's like, wow. And then from there, I just worked my way up. So I'm the only person who ever achieved, I went from the lowest possible position of campaigns intern to the highest possible position at Adbusters, which was, I was senior editor, editor, and guest editor. So yeah, Adbusters is awesome. Cullough is he's an artistic visionary who is a great person. And once you get on his wrong side, you're always on his wrong side. So that's somehow I got on his wrong side, unfortunately, but that's life. Any other questions? Do we have, how much time do we have? Do we have enough time to, okay, good. Okay, so I went to a school called European Graduate School. I don't know if anyone's ever heard of this school, but it's a cool, it's changing now, but it was really cool when I went there. It's kind of like a experimental, university in Switzerland, where you go there for these intensive seminars in the summer, and you meet with like uber famous philosophers like Zizek and Badu and Michael Hart and Rancière, Judith Butler, all these people I took classes with. And the thing that was so great about it is that they wouldn't just teach you what they had written like 2 years ago, they would just teach you literally what they were thinking about like that month. So you would be constantly learning things that other people wouldn't even read about. You know, basically you'd be reading the material for their books that would come out in like 3 or 4 years. And it was awesome and inspiring and forever like ruined me for academia, because it was like, you know, not, like my wife said, getting her PhD at UC Berkeley, which is much more traditional and prestigious. And this one was much more like half the kids are artists and everything, but it was awesome. And I did my dissertation, at the time I was at Adbusters, so I didn't want to do my dissertation about activism. I did my dissertation about the organization of knowledge in libraries and search engines, and the ramifications for, you know, whatever. So that's why my book, I'm very interested in where it ends up in the library, and like actually worked a lot with my editor about how to like certain, if you get into certain sections of the library, it's just like your book's gonna die. It's like, don't even go there. Don't put your book in certain, seriously. So yeah, it was an interesting experience, and there, it was beautiful. I mean, Switzerland is, you're up in the Swiss Alps in this resort, and it was sublime. It was very sublime. So, yeah. Yeah. All right. Was there any more questions before we go to people who have already asked a question? You've already asked a question, but you're on the list for anyone else before we go back to people who have asked questions already? Okay. No. Okay, go ahead. Yeah. Cool. Yeah. So that's one of my revolutionary scenarios, is this idea that women, a women's-based social movement, is the next kind of like revolutionary possibility. And I think I think that a lot of people kind of have this, the sense, like an intuition, that women are, first of all, they're a class of people that is oppressed globally in different ways in each country, but even in America. And one of the concepts that we don't have in America that's starting to also develop in Europe this idea of gender parity, that you should have an equal distribution of genders in positions of political power, which I think is a brilliant idea. And it makes perfect sense. Why is it that, you know, like if you look at positions of power in America and what percentage of them are women, it's very few, obviously. And what is that? What is the long-term ramifications for society? So anyways, I'm imagining in my book a movement that started to organize around that principle. In Europe, they have it a little bit. In fact, there's some European countries that they like corporate boards have to be, you know, equal or whatever. So I think that, so what would that take in a concrete way? In my book, I kind of talk about a world party, but I think that the way that it could get started is a contagious mood among women that's a kind of awakening. I think a taste of it that we got that was really, I think, effective was that video that was made in New York City about a woman like walking down the street and then people like all the stuff people were saying to her and all this garbage that was coming out of their mouths. And so it's that kind of, I think that what that video did really well for me was articulating the lived experience of being a woman and the daily like oppression. And I think that what you would want to do is create stuff like that that suddenly creates an awakening among women who use some sort of new tactic. It would probably not look like something that we've seen before, but that other women are suddenly drawn to. Like and right now, actually, there's an interesting phenomenon in China too with old women dancing in the streets, right? And I don't know if you guys have heard about this grannies, and they all go into the streets, they start dancing, and then the public gets really upset because apparently they're playing like loud music. And I was just thinking about how like that's a very interesting social phenomenon. I could almost imagine importing that into America and having like women dancing and like, you know, there's like just ways of thinking about it. So basically, that's the core idea, and then imagining like how could that play out in terms of like political sovereignty and, you know, yeah. To me, it's one of these things where I feel like it's almost like structuralism, like you don't actually have to like do anything, it's just gonna happen. Like, it's like a volcano, it's just like waiting to erupt, you know, it's gonna happen. And so the best thing to do is probably just like talk about it, encourage women. Somewhere out there there's like some female activists and they're just like thinking like, and then like they'll just like figure it out, you know, and then we'll all wake up and it's like, I don't understand why all these women are like protesting, but it's the next big thing. That's how I think it's gonna happen. It's gonna surprise us all, is what I'm saying. It'll be a surprise. That's the thing about revolutions, always happen when they're least expected. Oh, in fact, actually one thing that's interesting about the Russian Revolution is it started on International Women's Day. Something to think about. I know, no one talks about that. I was reading Trotsky and I was blown away. We have a question in the back, yeah? Well, I think obviously gender is really complicated because, you know, I'm not voting. I don't vote. I haven't voted since, like, what was it? I think I voted in 2004. I haven't voted in 12 years. Precisely because I think that it's the bait and switch game that, like, if you think about it, like, one way to think about it too is, like, we can only have one big social protest per year. So if I were a nefarious force, I would organize one large, big protest that just dissipates everyone's energy, right? Which they do. People's Climate March, for example. So it's the same with voting. There's something about the act of voting. Psychologically, you're signing your allegiance to this thing. And I just think it just messes up people's, I know it's really scary. It's like, well, what if Trump wins? But that's the same thing people say in every single election. And now 12 years later, I'm just starting to be like, this is a pattern, guys. Like, come on. Like, but I'm not, you know, if you guys want to vote, go for it. I don't know. Get it? Got to do your own thing sometimes. Okay. Do it. You have a question? Oh, in American activism? Oh. Oh man, I'm like so tuned out in terms of, it's not how I work. I think for me, like one thing I'm talking about in my book is, so in the end of my book, I have this section on like kind of the principles of revolution. And one of them is transposition and also another one is edge, which means that basically what we did with Occupy is we took a thing from the edge of politics and we transposed it to a new place. So for me, like what I find inspiring is stuff that's happening abroad. Like one thing, so you want to scour and look for protest tactics that are happening at the edges of politics. So I'm just more inspired by like one thing I find really inspiring is I disagree with the politics of it, but Russia has this amazing, these amazing social movement stuff happening right now. The Stop Ham, where they go out and they like put stickers over people's cars who are like violating traffic laws. Yeah, and they make these amazing videos. What they do amazing in Russia is they make these insane militant videos about them basically like shaming people. Like, and right wingers will like go and like shame gay people. I mean, it's like politically you're just like, this is disgusting. But something about the like aesthetic and the just something about it is like really edgy and really interesting. So anyways, to answer your question, I think American politics, Americans, this is my big critique of Black Lives Matter, for example, is that it's a regression back to American-centric politics where we look inward, whereas Occupy Wall Street was 100% global. We were linking up with movements around the world. We were looking outward into the world. And I just feel like Americans, like, we're too focused on ourselves. So to counteract that, I spend more time thinking about the international situation. But I know there's good stuff. I'm not saying there's not good stuff happening here. I'm sure there is. But for me, I just like, honestly, there's something wrong with American culture right now. I'll just say that. I will just say that's been my experience about something about American culture is there's some sort of quiet censorship happening in this country that we, in the urban areas, you guys don't seem to notice the spectrum of thought is very limited, I will just say. And even that extends to activism. Jerry, your question. I came back for you. A statement? No. Anyone have questions? Because you could come up and make statements at the signing table. I don't know about that. Do we want to take a vote? People want to vote on the statements. Statements are. Let's do the. Do you have a question? No. I don't vote in presidential elections. I'm talking about. Yeah. I'm not saying like we should. No, I don't believe in democratic process. No, of course. I believe that like we have to develop, democracy is one way of making complex decisions as a group, you know? So it's not a bad thing. I'm just saying that that there is something that happens psychologically. There's certain behaviors that you can do as a revolutionary that blunt your revolutionariness. And one of those would, I think, be becoming a drug addict and sitting in your room and doing drugs. That's an extreme example. Another example, voting. I'm sorry, but I think that, okay? I feel that, you know? It's unpopular. Every time I say it in a talk, people get upset, but you guys vote. If you really believe in it, it's fine. I'm willing to go with the decision of the group on that one. I am, because what I'm more interested in doing is creating a social movement that's gonna like overthrow whoever happens to win that rigged election of corporate money. Questions. Online campaigns. Excellent question. I talk about that in my book a little bit. That's really important. I think it's crucial to understand that, I call it clicktivism. If you Google clicktivism, you can read my Guardian piece that I wrote like 5 years ago that really, I think, if you read it and you realize it was written 5 years ago, it really anticipates Occupy Wall Street, especially the last paragraph. So actually it was written like a long time ago. Anyways, so the core thing to realize about Avaaz and why these people will never create a revolutionary social movement, literally they will never create a revolutionary social movement, is they have no intuition. They have no instinct. In fact, they don't like instinct. They don't like intuition. What they believe in is that you should market test every email to see what kind of click rate and open rate it gets. And then if it, like Avaaz actually has a formula, they send out a test email to like say 10% of their membership list. And then if like, you know, 50% of those people open it, and then like if 30% click on it, and then like if 20% sign up for the petition, that's a winning campaign. Okay, I'm gonna tell you guys the truth about Occupy Wall Street. No one liked the idea, no one wanted to listen to the idea, and people thought it was a bad idea, okay? It would have never passed the Avaaz click test. People did not like the idea. The media did not want to interview us about the idea. Only 200 people started organizing in New York City for the idea. It was a fringe idea that we didn't market test. So what I'm saying is that like this is more of the institutionalization of activism that's designed to blunt and diminish revolutionary potential in this country, because what their goal is to make sure that the one event that people can do per year is safe, not dangerous, and that everyone goes home feeling good, a little bit exhausted, and not protesting again until the next cycle. So they're just interested in like that's just the reality of what they do. And you know, if you start to research, like, one of the things I talk about in my book is front groups. And there are front groups, I believe, operating in this country. I talk about an example that was unmasked in the 70s and 60s. Obviously, it's hard to find evidence about this thing. But I believe that there are front groups in this country who are designed to masquerade as revolutionaries in order to prevent things like Occupy Wall Street from happening again. You know, so that's what I would say about, I wouldn't say Avaaz is necessarily a front group, but I would say that the idea that you can't trust your, you know, they should trust their instinct. The great revolutionary leaders of the past have had a tremendous instinct. Lenin, for example, was extremely unpopular in the months preceding the Russian Revolution. You know what they said about Lenin? That's the interesting thing about Lenin. They all said he was like a spy for the Germans. The people like did not like him. But he had a tremendous revolutionary intuition. He knew which way things were going. He sent the and he got it. He strategized the Bolsheviks into power. Even the Bolshevik Party itself didn't want to start the insurrection when he called for it. So what I'm saying is that the goal of an activist should be to cultivate that intuition. I talk about in my book, how do you cultivate that a little bit? I think it has to do with understanding what ideas make us a little bit afraid and going with those ones. So Avaaz is not willing to be afraid, you know? They would never call for something that could result in death. Occupy Wall Street resulted in death. People died. 7,000 people were arrested. People had their bones broken. Literally, you know? Like, you guys should Google this horrible reports that came out of Oakland about police officers breaking people's knees and, like, just vicious stuff, you know? That's a real, that means they had to do that to get people to stop protesting. Okay. You have a question, Jerry?
Yes, I do.
Okay. No. That is a good question. There is this kind of... No, that's a good question. That's a good question. There is this kind of... I don't know how to explain it. It's basically like movements eat themselves. I was talking to Scott about this in the car. Movements eat themselves. And there is this... I don't think anyone can really understand the fundamentally... horrific feeling of, and traumatic feeling, I think, traumatic feeling of the defeat of Occupy Wall Street. I think it was a trauma that we all experienced and that we all experienced it differently. I experienced it in Berkeley in a different way than the people of New York experienced it. But imagine, you're like leading a social movement that's like the biggest thing in like a generation and everyone thinks you're about, they raised like $1 million in cash donations, people sending warehouses full of things and the blah, 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 it was amazing. And so when it collapsed, I think there was a lot of kind of animosity to all of the other voices. And one of and fortunately, I think I was insulated from that because I worked at Adbusters. I don't care. You know, the reality is I'm going to tell you the truth about how it started. I'm going to tell you the truth of my experience. And so there's a lot of animosity within the movement to this day around what was Adbusters' role and how dare they say they created it, even though they picked the name, the location, the day. Oh, yeah, and I heard about it first from them. You know, like... How dare they take credit for something they created? No one creates anything. That's the narrative. No one creates anything. And that's a fine narrative. I think that was a narrative that Adbusters helped create, by the way. We helped create that by turning down all television interviews. We helped create that by giving almost every single interview. If they said, can you interview about Occupy Wall Street? We said, why don't you talk to a local person? Very few people. I accepted very few interviews, if you go back in that time, and that was intentional. So because that was the strength of the movement, that narrative. But the movement's over, and now we have to tell the truth about what happened so that we can understand how to create the next one. So I think that whether or not they're here, every single one of them is going to read my book, and I absolutely know it. Every single occupier is going to read that book. You have no doubt. There is no substitute for my book. And there is nothing. It was so difficult to get a book published about protests that there is no competition for my book. There is, if you look at like the last, people try to compare my book to something they say like Rules for Radicals. Rules for Radicals was published 40 years ago. It doesn't even have the internet 40 years ago. Okay, so like that says something, that the nearest book people can compare mine to is something written 40 years ago. So every single activist is going to read this book, but they can read it in their bedrooms and they can like talk about it. And it doesn't actually matter. It doesn't actually matter because I'm going to like, I mean, I put everything I know about activism into my book and it can have it. And that's why I wrote it. So, but I still love all the occupiers, and they were good people. But you know, we all over idealize them, myself included, and I had some bad experiences with some of them. One of them came to Nehalem and lived with me briefly, and it was not good. I had to ask him to leave. He was not a good person. Talk about front groups. That man worked for a front group. He totally worked for a front group. And he was there to, like, I don't know why he was there, but it wasn't pretty. And so, question from someone who works at the Strand. I love that. Yeah. Right. Right. Yeah. That's a great question. So the question basically is, what are the benefits of working together? This is how I interpret it. The benefits of working together or separately as a movement. Is it like all these different, there's all these different configurations and groups. Should we like create an umbrella, or we should kind of like work on our own? So I talk about that specific thing in the section on voluntarism, because there's this really interesting, if you haven't read it, there's this really interesting book published in the 70s by this guy, William Gamson. It's called The Strategy of Social Protest. And he does this kind of like, I mean, it's funny because he does like an empirical analysis of movements, of protests since like 1850 to 1950 or something like that. Anyways, one of the things that he says that's fascinating is that movements did not have a higher success rate when they worked together. He said that so right now there's a common perception among us that we need to join one big coalition and kind of like work together. He actually said that no, that's not true, that there's no indication that increases your success rate. And I will say that that's been my experience at Adbusters. We weren't working with a single person. Someone asked me about Kulla. Kulla doesn't work with anybody, literally. That man will not coalition with a soul. And that's something that he taught me. There's a lot of things, I think a lot of animosity among occupiers. They don't understand the culture that I was brought up in, which is Adbusters, very specific culture. They don't coalition. So we created the idea for Occupy Wall Street and we released it before we started to reach out to anyone about it. And it was only after we like said, hey, let's do this idea. And even at Adbusters, like we would, yeah. So my answer to you is that it's what's important instead is to work independently, to develop your intuition about revolutionary possibilities, and then get better and better at sparking them. Like since I was 17, every year I would do a different campaign, and then some of them would take off and some wouldn't. So I think it's more about like building a kind of small group of people who can, you know, create these eruptions, and then it gets into these other things about, you know, scaling it and making it permanent, and there's all these challenges. But the basic answer is no. Coalitions do not increase our effectiveness. In fact, I would say that they often decrease our effectiveness, and so not necessarily the mainstream perspective on activism, but. We have a question for someone who has not asked a question. Yeah. Yeah. Sovereignty. Yeah. 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 Right. Well, Yeah. That's a good question. So I think like so one of the things I try to talk about in my book is like, well, what is revolution? What does revolution mean? Because there's a lot of different definitions of revolution. And so the definition that I kind of bring up is like, it's a change in legal regime, you know? And so Citizens United is a court case of the highest court in the US government. So the only way to overturn the highest court decision in the US government would be a revolution, literally, you know? And so I think that, so that's the first thing. But the second thing is about sovereignty. I think the ultimate goal of social movements and social protests is to gain sovereignty. And what sovereignty means is that what you want is what you get, basically. You know, it means that you have the capacity and the power to say, no, it will be this way, you know, and that's what happens. And so in our world, there's only very few ways to gain sovereignty. And if you think about it like a game, so there's one way would be military conquest, right? We understand that if you conquer a territory as the victor, it's like in the Geneva and stuff, you can kind of like, I'm the new government here, guys. And like, and also there's like rules about, oh, and the civilians aren't supposed to like really resist you that much. But after World War II, leaving aside the fact that it's probably impossible and undesirable to do an armed insurrection in a Western government, but more importantly, point number two is that after World War II, they kind of outlawed wars of conquest. So they've kind of closed the door to the idea that you can gain sovereignty in our world through military occupation and this kind of stuff. I mean, it's weird with Russia now and the Ukraine. But so what I say is, I don't think that's an option. Instead, there's another option. It's winning elections. That's the other way you gain sovereignty. And sovereignty, though, is so it's a challenge of, well, how do you win elections and where do you win them and what's the best strategic place to win them in? And I think the best strategic place to start winning elections is in rural communities where there's very few police, there's very little competition because the other people who are on city council are like literally 80 years old and just want to retire because there's no young people there, because there's no jobs there, so there's no one to take their position. Like, instead of in the urban areas, there's this animosity to the upcoming generation. In the rural areas, there's like a gratitude. Like, thank you for living out here. And like, you know, I wish my son and daughter would move back to these communities. Like, so to answer your question, yeah, sovereignty is this, it's something that can be, it's bestowed upon you for doing certain, winning certain games that the society has created. One game is war. I don't think we should play that one necessarily. Another game is elections. You can't win sovereignty by just holding an assembly and like using twinkle fingers. Although I think we believed that we could. It's called prefigurative anarchism. And I was kind of convinced that maybe we would be able to too, but it turns out you can't. The police are not beholden to the assembly. Okay. Yeah. Right. I agree. I understand what you're saying, but I think that what I'm talking about isn't how to have the most people possible involved in a movement. What I'm saying is, how do you? Let's just imagine. I mean, there's 280 people in my town. There's 80 households. Okay. It's not as small as Zuccotti was, but it's not much bigger than Zuccotti. You know what I mean? It's very, very small. So if we just imagine like, I want to have some place on Earth where I'm the lawmaker, where I can pass a law that says anything, like there will be free food for occupiers. We will provide stipends to all activists. We will do things that annoy the federal government. You know, like we have and I talk about this in my book, where I live is on we have a port with access to the ocean. There's all kinds of campaigns I can imagine if you are willing to be an activist city council. What I'm saying is that activists need to like pick up these discarded weapons. There's a discarded weapon, it's called city councils in rural areas, and use them in innovative and new ways that would surprise people. And I think you would see the federal government react in very interesting ways if they realized that, wow, what? There's actually a city in Oregon like that's like activist city council and they wanna like, what are they doing? You know, what I'm saying is like, we don't need a movement that's the largest. We've already, it's like India. They already have that. Like in Brazil, there's a million people yesterday in Brazil protesting. Let's stop fetishizing the largest protest and instead start fetishizing like the most sovereign or the one with the greatest capacity to carry out its will, you know? So, but I don't think you've asked a question either. This is awesome. Yeah, not enough. I mean, I got to keep studying that stuff. I think you're right. I mean, I think, yeah, all I can answer that question is by saying, not definitely not enough. I need to study it more. But the one element I think of the of those movements that didn't appeal necessarily, but struck me as oddly very fascinating was, this is such an isolated example, but I don't remember her name, but she basically, she would do these like self-harm behaviors as protests. Like once I think she threw herself down the stairs, and then she ultimately died by standing in front of the king's horse during a race, and it trampled her and she died. And so there's something, which is oddly kind of like how the Arab Spring started, with someone setting themselves on fire. So there is something there with these, I think you're right, let's go back, study that stuff, and let's take what is inspiring and like transpose it to today and mix it up and make it weird, and this is how it works. This is how you create a surprising social movement, is by giving people something new and innovative that suddenly gets them excited, you know? So, it feels like we...
It is getting late. I don't want to silence anybody, but if you're down to hang around and sign some books, we can keep this going. And I want to thank all of you who asked questions and those of you who listened. And I want to thank Micah for coming out and spending his evening with us.
Yeah, thank you.
So give Micah and yourselves a hand.